ways of the people of Ahl Sunnah versus the ways of the people of innovation in religion and bid'ah. And this is a subject that is always repeated, that it's needed to be always repeated, because we are living at times of too much changes and tribulations and things of that nature. So it's important for the Muslim to always guard one's iman and to protect one's faith, because first of all, just make it inshallah short points, we are in need of two types of guidance. The first type is for the person to be guided to the deen of Islam, to be guided from al-kufr to al-iman, from disbelief to faith. And then once a person is a Muslim, he still needs the guidance with every step he takes to be away from all of the different deviant beliefs and perceptions and things of that nature. In every action, matters of belief, in matters of ibadah, in matters of manners, in everything. So the constant need of the hidayah is something that we're all in need of, and that's why we say ihdina as-sirata al-mustaqim in Surah Al-Fatiha. Because the question is, if a person is guided, what's the significance of asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be guided every time we recite Surah Al-Fatiha many times every day? It's because of this, because we are constantly in need of guidance in every single thing that we do in our life. And because of that, then it's because it's been repeated so many times, and we know that this ummah split like the nations before. So it's important to know what is the truth in all of this split and deviation. And it becomes a matter of belief, and then the Muslim will keep on guarding himself to protect himself from any deviation. And the way of the Quran and the way of the Prophet ﷺ, that it shows always the good and the bad. And sometimes people don't like to hear about the bad. They just want to hear about what is good. Or they think that if we talk about what is bad, it's splitting the Muslims more and causing more friction and maybe hatred or divisions or disunity or whatever that is. And this is definitely a wrong way, a wrong belief, a wrong perception. Because the way of the Quran, the way of the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, that we are entrusted to show what is good and to hold fast to it, and to also show and warn against what is evil and to stay away from it. So this is a duty that we have to follow. And it's even more important when people sometimes they're shy away from talking about what is evil and what is deviation, with the doubt that they would have in their minds that to talk about these things again disunite the Muslims, and we are in need to be together. So forget about the differences, so that we all face one challenge, all of us as Muslims, and others they don't differentiate between a Muslim that has a deviant belief or a correct belief, they're all treated as one. Which is, when it comes to dealing with others, yes, this is one of the things that of hikmah that a person has to use. And that's why the ulama, they make this very clear, that when it's Muslims versus kuffar, there are certain way of working together. For example, if Muslims are in need to have a cemetery in the city, for example, do we have to have the cemetery for only specific group of people? And if anybody has a wrong aspect in matter or aqeedah or so, then they don't come into our cemetery and each people have their own cemetery? Of course not. All the Muslims, you know, even though some of them might have deviations, sins, whatever, as long as they're within the boundary of Islam, this is something that they should all get together, and they would have to get together to do something like this. Or dealing with others, in that sense, the ta'amulat or the matters of dealing is different than making sure that things are correct and sound in everything that we do in our life. The same thing that we even try to explain to the non-Muslims, that we can, when it comes to dealings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to be kind and to be lenient and to take care of our neighbors and so on. But there is something called kufr al-iman. There is something called belief and disbelief, right? So this matter has to be clear. It doesn't mean that someone is a disbeliever, that means we have to treat him bad. Who said that? What is the relationship between both? It's not there. We follow the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, but the matter has to be clear. So there is kufr and there is iman, there is disbelief and there is faith and belief, and there is haqq and batil, there is truth and there is falsehood in everything that we do, and we have to put things again in perspective. So there is haqq and batil bi'tibar, or with regards to disbelief and iman again, and there is haqq and batil within the believers in the same circle of al-Islam. There is always haqq and batil. Two people, two groups of people, they're saying two opposite things, one is right and one is wrong. And it doesn't mean that when we want to know what is right and we hold fast to what is right, is that we will necessarily deal with the one that doesn't have this with an evil approach or something like this. We'll deal with one another also according to the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Even boycotting or not boycotting, all of this is clearly mentioned in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ with clear criteria of how to follow that. So because of that, this is something so important, so that we can keep our deen clear to us and steadfast on the deen of Allah, regardless of the fitan or the tribulations or the call of unity without understanding of our matters of belief, so that we protect the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our life. And we might talked about that before many times, the characteristics of the people of Ahl Sunnah. And as we said, we focus more inshallah ta'ala about the people of Al-Bid'ah other than Ahl Sunnah, and from that also we'll talk about some of the aspects of the people of Ahl Sunnah briefly in the next half an hour or so. That needs a long time, and maybe one of the books that we can study is in this subject. But when we look, I'll start right away with the people of innovations in general, to get an understanding what are they classified in their classification and where they're coming from. It's usually best to talk about the truth, right? But this time we're talking about the deviation. Ahlul Bid'ah, when the ulama talk about the people of Al-Bid'ah, they're referring to certain usul or certain principles. And these major sects that deviated from the way that was at the time of the Prophet ﷺ and the Sahaba radiallahu anhu and the Tabi'een, where the Prophet ﷺ said, عَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِينَ مِنْ بَعْدِ عَضُوا عَلَيْهَا بِالنَّوَاجِبِ وَإِيَّكُمْ وَمُحْدَثَاتِ الْأُمُورِ فَإِنَّ كُلَّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٌ. When he said عليه الصلاة والسلام, فَإِنَّهُ مَنْ يَعِشْ مِنْكُمْ فَسَيَرَى اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. Whoever live among you will see many differences. So stay on my sunnah, my way, and the way of the rightly guided Khalifa, Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali. Bite on it with your molar teeth and be warned against matters of bid'ah or innovation. So this is the pure way, and this is the way of the people of Ahl Sunnah and Jama'ah, and this is what we need to hold fast to with their principles and so on. The major classifications of Al-Bid'ah, how it started at the end of the time of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, with the first ones are the Khawarij and the Qadariyah. So these are major ones, and it's not theory, it's not just different sects, it's something to protect our own iman, because there are things still present today that comes from the same usul or from the same principles. So regardless of the historical background of who's first and who's second, there are major ones. There's the Khawarij, right? And we talked about the Khawarij before. And the Khawarij, they became Khawarij, they became deviant, and the Prophet ﷺ mentioned them in the hadith, and you heard about them many times, because they mainly went against and rebelled against the Khalifa Uthman radiallahu anhu. And they had deviant beliefs in which they would claim a Muslim committing a major sin becomes a kafir, and therefore they would fight against him and so on and so forth with the different beliefs. But this first deviation, one of the first deviations, sometimes people till today can fall into the same principles. So that's why the ulama, they say, those who split the Muslims with regards to matters of iman and kufr, claiming a Muslim to be a kafir, making takfir of the Muslimin because of the major sins, without knowledge like this. And they would, as they say, lift the sword against the Muslimin, fight Muslims. They would kill Muslims. This is part of their religion, part of their belief is to kill and to shed blood of the Muslims first, right? So anyone that would have similarities with them is following their ways. They are famous, as it happened at the time of Uthman radiallahu anhu, they rebel against the rulers. And that sound, as we said before, it sounds appealing to many, when they see injustices and so on among the Muslim world, they say, why not? Why not just rebel and have revolutions against these rulers because they're unjust and so on? The matter is, this is a matter of deen. And if the ruler is a Muslim and he is unjust, it is not permissible to rebel against him. This is our deen. Whether a person likes this or not, or makes sense to him or not, or claims that these people, those who say that, they are just pro-government and they're traitors and they're taking money from the governments, that whoever says whatever they want to say. We have nusus, we have texts that we have to follow. So to make it halal or permissible for people to fight Muslims, to fight unjust Muslims, to fight bad Muslims, to fight corrupted Muslims, where is that in the Quran and the Sunnah? In the way that it is done and then bloodshed and so on. This is all following the same concept of the Khawarij. Even if the people are not claiming that or believing that a person committing a major sin is a kafir, but still the concept that has been widespread so much because of the lack of knowledge of matters of the deen, you don't like something, just go out on the street and try to do something about it, right? So this is, the concept itself is a deviant concept. And it comes from the usul or the principles of Al-Khawarij. The Muslim, the people of Ahl Sunnah, they endure patience for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when it comes to Muslims dealing with one another, to be patient with one another, and following what the Prophet ﷺ ordered them at times of injustices and so on. So this is a subject, just briefly like this. If you talk about another major sect of deviation, is the opposite of that, which is the murji'ah, or those who claim as long as you have the belief, you are fine. Deeds does not affect your iman. And there are levels in this. So imitated the Christians in their belief, that as long as you believe that Isa alayhi salam is your savior, you can live your life the way you like. So the murji'ah, there are levels again, some extreme and some less extreme. But this is their principles. And some people till today might fall into the same deviation. That's why we need to be warned against these deviant belief or understanding. They would say that as long as I have my faith in my heart, it's okay for me to do whatever I want to do. Right? Even take the person to the level where he doesn't pray, for example. He says, I don't have to pray because faith is in the heart. Or I have to do this because the faith is in the heart and I love Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is not a simple statement for a person to say. It's not about the sin that is being committed. It's the root of the sin. One thing is for a person to commit a sin because he committed a sin. He was weak or so. But what is dangerous is when the sin is rooted down in a deviant belief. This can take the person away from the path of the people of Ahlul Sunnah, become a deviant. And someone else might fall into the sin because he's weak, but he's not different or does not have a different belief in matters of belief. So this is something with the matter of al-irja. So a person has to purify his heart to know what is the belief in matters of iman. That al-iman is belief and actions, speech, what's in the heart is matters of belief, deeds done by the heart, what we say with our tongue, and what we do physically. All of this is part of the iman. Some of it, of course, can take the person outside the fold of Islam if a person doesn't believe in La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, and other things. If a person misses it, it's just in the level of sins. So this is with the principles of those who are murji'ah and those who would follow their ways. There is also with these major ones are the Mu'tazilis or Mu'tazila, right? And the Mu'tazila, yes, although the name is in the past, and Wasil ibn Ata is the leader, but the same concept, it's still present among many of the Muslims today. Whether they know it or not, it is not just about the actions that they do. And the main thing about the Mu'tazilis, and of course we're very briefly just talking of some points of each of these major sects, but their major thing is, they would reject the text, the clear evidences, because of their own reason. So this is their main or their biggest fitna. They put the aql or their reason forward before the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is very clear deviation, of course. So if a hadith is authentic and it's not according to what that particular person, because whose aql? Allah knows best. His aql or this aql. There are millions of reasons and millions of intellects. Which one? Allah knows best. Becomes a very confusing thing. So they would reject what the Prophet ﷺ said. They cannot reject the clear Quran, of course, the verses of the Quran, otherwise they become disbelievers. So what do? They explain the verses of the Quran in a very deviant way, so that nothing will go against their own particular reason or intellect. So this is a very deviant principle. And the same thing, you might find people would fall into the same thing with putting reason in everything that we do, or anything that we want, we're ordered to do in matters of the deen, or things that are forbidden matters of the deen. As we said earlier, your reason, or the reason of the human being, or his intellect, led him by the message being presented to him to be a Muslim. The person has to make sure that he understands what makes him a Muslim is La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah, which means the only one that we worship is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the only one that we follow is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You already agreed to this. You already made this as a covenant between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that the only one that you would worship is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the only one that you would follow in the absolute sense is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Following means that we follow. The concern is to know. Once we know the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that's it, no questions are asked. وَمَا كَادَ لِمُؤْمِنِ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَ اللَّهُ رَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَنْ يَكُودَ لَهُمْ خِيَرَةٌ مِنْ أَمْرِهِ. It is not for a believing man and woman, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decree a matter, that they have a choice. Right? So this is a principle in aqidah. This is, we're not talking about sins, we're talking about principles that are either deviation or proper principles. So the Mu'tazila, they were the ones that leaders in this matter, and came from them many different branches of deviations and sects. And for example, Imam Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari, rahimahullah, he was Mu'tazili first. He was one of the students of Wasl ibn Ata. And then he repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from this way, and he refuted the ways of the Mu'tazilis, but he still had some deviations, but not as the Mu'tazilis. Mainly, and it's not just in the principles of the Mu'tazila, because they denied the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and things like this, and other things with even the Iman and Kufr, they were similar to the Khawarij in the fact that if a person commits a major sin and dies in the state of a major sin, they would call him, he is in manzila bayna manzilatayn. He's in a level between two levels. He's not a believer and he's not a kafir, but he's in hellfire forever. It's the same outcome. So Imam al-Hasan al-Ash'ari, as an example, he repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from this, but he's still in the beginning. That's a second stage in his life, because he went through three stages. Many people do not know that. The first one was in the thing of al-i'tizal. And then the madhab of al-Ash'ari, which famously related to him because of his second stage, where the main thing in the asma wa sifat and the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he and also the Maturidis, as Abu Mansur al-Maturidi, rahimahullah, they only said that only seven of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are to be taken the way it is. And the rest, they make ta'wil. They don't deny it, otherwise the person will be denying the Quran. But just making ta'wil of it, changing the meaning of it. No, it means this. It means this. But at least seven are, I always forget them, but it's al-haya wal-qudra wal-irada, life and the power and the will, al-ilm, knowledge, and the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-sam', the hearing, al-basar, the seeing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-kalam, the speech of Allah. They believe in these attributes. Only they picked these seven. Where's the rest? The rest might mean similarities or resemblance of the human beings and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing is the like of him. Right? Well, sam', Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the all-hearer, and they believe that. Human beings, they also hear. Does that mean that the attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the like of the attribute of the human being? Of course not. Nothing is the like of Allah. Sure, so that means the sam', or the hearing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is not the like of that of the human beings. And nothing is the like of Allah. They will say yes. So what's the difference between that and the rest of the attributes? Apply the same principles, you'll be safe. And who invented this? Why seven? The Sahaba radiallahu anhu, they didn't have these things. So this was the second stage that the madhab of al-Ash'ira is established on today. Right? And the same thing with the Maturidi. What many people do not know is that Imam al-Hasan al-Ash'ari himself, he repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from this, and he made clear statements. أنا على مذهب أحمد. I am on the way of Ahmad, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, rahimahullah, and he had two books about this. One is Al-Ibana fi Usul al-Diyana, famous book by Imam al-Hasan al-Ash'ari, his kitab Al-Ibana, going back against all of this, going back to the aqidah of al-Salaf, to the belief of al-Salaf. Right? And Maqalat al-Islamin also, he, in that book also, he repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and changed. So this is his last stage of his life. But still, those who follow the madhab of al-Asha'ira in matters of al-A'tiqad, they still called Asha'ira, in which, in reality, they should be called, as the ulama, they say, al-Kallabiyya. Why? Because this is basically the madhab of al-Kallabiyya, because Imam al-Hasan al-Ash'ari, he turned away from this. He repented to Allah from this. So it's unfair for people to claim that they are followers of him when he's not like that. He repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the last part of his life. Right? In which, of course, people of Ahlul Sunnah of Jama'ah in this, all the names and attributes of Allah, we believe in all of them. No difference between one or the other. And we know the meaning of it, of course. No resemblance or similarities to the attributes of the human being, because laysa kamithlihi shay'un wa as-sami'u al-basir. Nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he's the al-hira, the al-seer. We do not know how these things, these attributes are, because we don't have the knowledge of it. And the famous, again, quote of Imam Malik rahimahullah, when the man asked him about al-istiwa al-arsh, being on the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is over his throne, the man asked him about this. Imam Malik rahimahullah, he said to him, which is basically the same principle with all of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, al-istiwa'u ma'lum, al-istiwa' to rise over his throne. This is ma'lum, this is known linguistically, we know what it means. Well, iman bihi wajib, and to believe in it, it's mandatory, because that's mentioned in the Quran, Sunnah of the Prophet and so on. Wa al-kayfu majhul, and how that is majhul. We do not know, we don't have the knowledge of this. وَالسُّؤَلُ عَنْهُ بِدْعَةٍ, and to ask about it. This is bid'ah, this is innovation to get into this. We don't have the knowledge of this. So, and he ordered for this man as well. So the same thing with all the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and other things in matters of qadr and so on. So again, the principles of the Mu'tazila, it stayed somehow with these types of deviations. Although, of course, the deviations are levels, as we will see inshaAllah ta'ala, and I want to read to you some of the things that, or one major statement by Sheikh Sam Damiel, so to be able to put things in the right perspective. And other people, they follow some of the principles of the Mu'tazila. Those are, I don't know if it's fair to call them secularist Muslims, for example. I'm not sure. When you say a secularist Muslim or secular Muslim, as if you're saying a Christian Muslim, they don't go together, right? It doesn't make sense. But basically, sometimes people say this and they're proud of themselves to be like this. Why? Because they think that they know everything and they have their reason, mashallah, and they're very smart to know what is good for them and what's not, and they reject some things and they accept some things and according to their own liking and thinking. And that's why you would find them in every matter, they would have to put their reason in it, right? And the religion becomes just the reason versus the wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And again, the believers, they believe that everything is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's perfect. And whether people understand it or not, and nothing from the deen of Allah will oppose the clear, sound mind. It's the problem in their own minds. And there are some things in the wahi that oppose the apparent things of things, because that's ghaib, it's unseen. And nobody knows the outcome of actions. We think that everything has to be like we see it physically. If I'm hungry, I eat, I become satisfied. I'm not hungry, people think it's the same thing. If you see something in your life, then you have to do it this way, and the outcome of it is very clear. No, who said that? وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلَهُ مُخْرَجًا. Whoever fears Allah and is obedient to Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make ways outward. And always, every time it comes to this, and we've talked about it many times, remember the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested the believers and the messengers of Allah, like the major one, the story of Nuh alayhi salam and the ship, and you know, it should have been something that people can make sense to or reason with, but the wahi came in such a way to test the people. So we have to really submit ourselves to the wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is with all of its branches and so on, but people are living in this, as we said. And there is the Qadariyya, those who deny the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they also have things with their own intellect and reason. They talk about it and they talk about it without evidence, and this is also a matter of deviation. And there is Abu Fidr, those who curses the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, or say they're kuffar, or whatever there is, and they are one of the miseries that afflicted this ummah from a long time ago. And they also, they're always war against the Muslimin, never against anyone else. And they're always one of the sources of destruction to the Muslim ummah at all times. And people read their history, they will see that clearly. So the same thing, if a person, how can a person from Ahl Sunnah resemble them? Of course, there's no way, because they can never meet that way. But sometimes you would find some people talking not in a very good way about the Sahaba, even if it's not the level of the Rafida, but you know, talking about some of the Sahaba, Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, or Amr ibn al-As, or something like this, not following what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the Sahaba and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These are people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose them to be the first generation, those who saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and sat with him and so on. So this is the same thing, or the same principle. So this is in general some of the major ones, and then many of the different sects, you know, came from these sects, and that's why no matter what deviation that you see today, you can trace it back to some of these principles. So that's why it's very important for the Muslim to know this and to stay away from it, and to protect his iman from all of these deviant principles, and to follow the deen it was, the way it was at the time of the Prophet والسلام, and the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, and the early generations of Islam, and the Imam al-Arba'ah, the four Imams, right? And this is how things were, and this is till today, those who followed them with goodness and so on. Because of the time, I would like to mention something that Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah rahimahullah, when he talked about he was talking about some of the Asha'ira, basically, because sometimes people have extremism in even dealing with one another, because they're, you know, we're all Muslims, right? There is deviation, and a person has to put it in the right perspective, and we pray behind each other and all these types of things, but we have to make sure that we're protected from deviant beliefs. Although these types of things most of the time is not taught in the masajid, the deviant beliefs of the Asha'ira or the Maturidiyya and so on, it's only taught in the academic part of it, because people won't understand it. They would not understand it. It's very strange, very difficult to understand. The deen should not be very difficult to understand. That's why they even split the matters of deen into ilahiyat, and they call it aqliyat. And there is the sam'iyat, or the things that has to do with the ghaib. They make the tawheed from the aqliyat, from the things that you can put your intellect in. But when it comes to the sam'iyat, the unseen, the hereafter, ala adab al-qabr, and so on, this is like everybody else. But the people of Ahl Sunnah, everything is sam'iyat. If it's from the Quran and the Sunnah, we submit ourselves to it, and we understand it the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to understand it, the way that Sahaba radiallahu anhu did. So Shaykh Salim Taymiyyah, he said something very briefly, and I hope that you're paying attention, inshallah. I know that the subject, we've been talking about things to soften the hearts and purification of the soul, and this is very important also, principles to follow, so that no purification of the soul and no goodness in our hearts unless we have the sound aqidah, that is, these things are built on it. Without it, then it's no benefit. Waqtasad ala sunnah khayrun ijtihadin fil bid'ah. To do less, but you're in the sunnah, is better than to do so much, but you are in a bid'ah, having some innovative principles that you follow, not the ways of the people of Ahlus Sunnah. So he said, rahimahullah, about when he talked about some of the Asha'ira, he said, إِنَّهُ مَا مِنْ هَؤُلَاءِ, and this is in his book, there's a book by Shaykh Salim Taymiyyah, a very huge one, دَرْءِ تَعَارُضْ الْعَقْلِ وَالنَّقْلِ, to refute the contradiction between al-aql, the reason, and al-naql, which is the text. There's no contradiction between both, right? So this is many volumes that he refuted all of these things that people deviated away from the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of this issue that came from outside, when Muslims expanded and people came into with their baggages and their philosophy. Even the Sufis, it's all from other religions, other ways of life, the ways of their purification of their soul, whether it's from the Greeks or from the Hindus or from whatever, and they added this to the Deen of Allah. And that's why one of the principles or one of the things that deviants will take their religion from is other religions. They take sometimes from other religions. When we are ordered to take from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, and there are many principles of course, but this is one of them. So he said, ثُمَّ إِنَّهُ مَا مِنْ هَؤُلَاءِ إِلَّا مَنْ لَهُ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ مَسَاعٍ مَشْكُورٍ. He says, he was talking about the Asha'ir, Shaykh Sintami. He said, there is none of them unless he has in Islam very great work in Islam and for them to be thanked for their work for the Deen of Allah. وَحَسَنَاتٍ مَبْرُورَةٍ, and righteous good deeds and so on. وَلَهُ فَالرَّدِّ عَلَى كَثِيرٍ مِّنْ أَهْلِ الْإِلْحَادِ وَالْبِدَعِ وَالْإِنْتِصَارِ لِكَثِيرٍ مِّنْ أَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ وَالدِّينِ مَا لَا يَخْفَى عَلَى مَنْ عَرِفَ أَحْوَالَهُ. He said, and they have so much defended the Deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and refuted many of the people of Ilhad, atheism and innovations. One of the beautiful things to refute Al-Mu'tazila was written by the Asha'ira, refuting their ways and so on, and making victory to many of the ways of Ahl Sunnah and the Deen. مَا لَا يَخْفَ عَلَى مَنْ عَرِفَ أَحْوَالَهُ. It is not hidden for those who know them. A great ulama, and they defended the Deen and so on. وَتَكَلَّمَ فِيهِمْ بِعِلْمٍ وَصِدْقٍ وَعَدْلٍ. And to speak about them with ilm, with knowledge, and truthfulness, and fairness. Because some people, they don't have this fairness. If someone has a deviation, they talk about them as if they're talking about the kuffar. We have to put things in the right perspective, but at the same time, to be warned and to take precautions so that we don't fall into these matters of deviation. Then he said, لَكِنْ لَمَّا الْتَبَسَ عَلَيْهِمْ هَذَا الْأَصْلِ الْمَأْخُوذِ ابْتِدَاءً مِّنَ الْمُعْتَزِلَةِ. When the matter was confused to them, when they took this from the Mu'tazila, these deviant principles from the Mu'tazila, وَهُمْ فُضَلَاءُ وَقَلَاءُ, and they are righteous people, and they are wise people. اِحْتَاجُوا إِلَىٰ قَرْضِهِ وَالْتِزَامِ لَوَزِمِ. When they took these principles, they had to not contradict themselves, so they would still fall into more contradictions, because they have to follow these principles. Although they are people of virtuousness and righteousness and deen and so on. وصار الناس بسبب ذلك, and people became as a result of this, منهم من يعظمون لما لهم من المحاسن والفضائل. Some people, they would exalt them and respect them and so on, because they have محاسن, they have great things and virtuous things. ومنهم من يذمهم, and the other extreme, those who would attack them. لما وقع في كلامهم من البدع والباطل, because of what came into their words with innovation and باطل and distortions and so on. And he says, وَخِيَارُ الْأُمُورِ أَوْسَطُهُ, and the best is the middle course in this. قُلْ وَهَذَا لَيْسَ مَخْصُوصًا بِهَؤُلَاءِ. This is not specifically for them only, for meaning the Asha'ira only. بَلْ مِثْلُ هَذَا وَقَعَ لِطَوَائِفٍ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ وَالدِّينِ. But the same thing happened to people of knowledge and religion. Nobody is secure from falling into mistakes and so on. And he says, وَاللَّهُ تَعَالَى يَتَقَبَّلُ مِنْ جَمِيعِ عِبَادِهِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ الْحَسَنَاتِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts from all of the believers their hasanat, their good deeds. وَيَتَجَاوَزُ لَهُمْ عَنَ السَّيِّئَاتِ, and he forgives their sins. And then he quotes the ayah, رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لَنَا وَلِإِخْوَانِنَا الَّذِينَ سَبَقُونَ بِالْإِيمَانِ وَلَا تَجْعَلْ فِي قُلُوبِنَا غِلًّا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا رَبَّنَا إِنَّكَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. Which means, O Allah, رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لَنَا, O Allah, forgive us, that's what the ayah says, and to our brothers, those who surpassed us in matters of iman, and do not make in our hearts hatred to those who believe. رَبَّنَا إِنَّكَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. يقول ولا ريب أن من اجتهد في طلب الحق والدين من جهة الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said, there's no doubt that whoever seeks the truth and the deen from the way of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم وأخطأ في بعض ذلك, and he made a mistake in some of this, فالله يغفر له خطأ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive his mistake. He's sincere. He's someone that wants to follow the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, but he made a mistake. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive his mistake. تَحْقِيقًا لِلْدُعَاءِ الَّذِي اسْتَجَابَهُ اللَّهُ لِنَبِيِّهِ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he said, as it's mentioned in the last two verses of Surah Al-Baqarah, رَبَّنَا لَا تُؤَخِذْنَا إِن نَسِيْنَا وَأَخْطَأْنَا. Oh Allah, do not take us accountable for what we made in forgetfulness or made a mistake. So a'immah of this deen, they can make a mistake. You don't follow them in the mistake, and at the same time, you don't make them among the people of evil and so on. Their goal was to follow the way of the Prophet ﷺ, and it happened, and that's why human beings are not safe from deviation and so on. But we have to know the truth and to follow it, and to they live in such a way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. He says, وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَ ظَنَّهُ وَهَوَهُ فَأَخَذَ يُشَنِّي عَلَى مَنْ خَلَفَ. Whoever follows his expectations or his thinking and his desire, and he kept on attacking anyone that is different than him, بِمَا وَقَعَ فِيهِ مِنْ خَطَأ ظَنَّهُ صَوَابًا. They would attack those who made a mistake. They are thinking that they are doing right. بعد اجتهاد. After he made his اجتهاد. He's a alim. Not talking about normal people. We're talking about these great a'imma of the deen. وهو من البدع المخالفة للسنة. And he fell into some of the bid'ah that is opposing to the sunnah. فإنه يلزمه نظير ذلك أو أعظم أو أصغر في من يعظمه هو من أصحابه. If he does this, then he should do the same thing for the one that he respects and loves from his companions or from his friends. Why? فَقَلَّ مَنْ يَسْلَمْ مِنْ مِثْلِ ذَلِكَ فِي الْمُتَأْخِرِينَ. Because rarely anyone can be saved from making any mistakes. لِكَثْرَةِ الْإِشْتِلَاهِ وَالْإِبْتِرَاهِ. Because there's so many things that can be confused for the people, especially for fitan. And this is what made some people, they fell into this. When they would justify for themselves attacking the a'imma of the deen just because they had some matter of deviation here or there, right? Attack them, then they would end up doing what? Attacking their own people, attacking their own scholars, and it never ends. They keep on splitting and splitting and splitting, and the life becomes just attacking, attacking. And this is what Shaykh Sam Tamir is saying, that, you know, very clearly, فَقَلَّ مَنْ يَسْلَمْ. They would do the same thing for their own people. So you would find the person at a certain time, he's so much exalted. He is the alim of the ummah. And after a few years, he is a mubtada' and so on. Because he made a mistake. Right? Yani, subhanAllah, this is not the way of the people of Al-Sunnah. See how the mercy in the hearts of the people of Al-Sunnah. He says, فَقَلَّ مَنْ يَسْلَمْ مِنْ ذَلِكَ مِنْ مِثْلِ ذَلِكَ فِي الْمُتَأْخِرِينَ لِكَثْرَةِ الْإِشْتِلَاهِ وَالْإِضْطِرَابِ. The later generations, there are more confusion in their lives and the more things. So people need to be forgiving, and but still being firm on the truth and not to fall into this of attacking and refuting and so on. وَبُعْدُ النَّاسِ عَنْ نُورِ النُّبُوَّةِ. And people are away, far away now from the light of the prophethood. The more generations come, the more they're away from the light of the prophethood. وَشَمْسِ الرِّسَالَةِ. And the sun of the risala, of the message of the Prophet ﷺ, الَّذِي بِهِ يَحْصُلْ الْهُدَى وَالصَّوَابِ. Where people become guided and they become on the truth. وَيَزُولُ بِهِ عَنِ الْقُلُوبِ الشَّكُ وَالْإِرْتِيَابِ. And it removes from the hearts the doubt and al-irtiyab or confusion and so on. Especially, again, to add to this, we're not talking about the principles of the people of Al-Sunnah. This is now safe. You can know clearly the aqidah of Al-Sunnah and how the ulama of Al-Sunnah, they consensus and agreed upon these matters of principles. So nobody has an excuse to be away from this. But situations that happens in our livelihood, and some of the ulama would say something about an azila or something that is happening in the world today, and he makes a mistake, right? This is where people need to leave it, of course, to the people of knowledge, and not to follow anyone in his deviation, but to have this mercy towards one another when it comes to making mistakes. It's valid. Anybody can make mistakes. And this is how Shaykh Hussain Tamir and the ulama, they went into through this path. Otherwise, again, a person would end up refuting his own self, right? So this is the way of the people of knowledge, but at the same time, we should not separate between what is mentioned earlier and now, is that it becomes our duty because we can fall into extremes. Everything becomes okay and everybody is forgiven and no problem. Don't talk about differences, don't talk about deviations. No, this is a duty in our religion. And we have to talk about differences and to put it in the right perspective. And we have to make sure that we correct ourselves in the smallest thing ever, and the most important thing in matters of Aqidah, of course, and all of these different sects that we talked about, opposed to all of that is the way of the people of Ahl-Sunnah and Jama'ah. And we see the people of Ahl-Sunnah and Jama'ah, we're not talking about ourselves in particularly to praise ourselves, to say that we're great, we're on the truth, you have to follow us. There's no such a thing. We have to follow the people of Ahl-Sunnah and Jama'ah, the principles of Ahl-Sunnah and Jama'ah, and to call people to this and to be patient with them when it comes to this. Otherwise, a person will have deviation accordingly. So, to be away from all of these firq, all of these sects, and to be united on matters of the Tawheed and the ways of in people and Sunnah, wal Jama'ah, and to refer to the people of knowledge, of course, when it comes to all of our efforts.